like to talk about this afternoon is understanding a little what's happening in a volume phase grating. And this model is, perhaps as Hans says, a more simplistic model than offered by current coupled wave theory. And it's based on Fresnel reflection. So I've tried to make this talk as non-mathematical as possible. The written paper which accompanies this conference is in the proceedings is the simplest possible mathematical introduction. And for those interested in a proper exposition of the theory, then there are a couple of published papers listed here, and those references are in the proceedings. So, I should also say that this theory is described in detail in my book with Hans, entitled Ultra-Realistic Imaging, Advanced Techniques in Analog and Digital Color Holography, and there's a leaflet for that on the reception desk. So, existing coupled wave theory. This was introduced by Kujelnik in about 1969, and Kujelnik's highly successful theory works by finding an approximate solution of the wave equation by essentially assuming two waves, a reference illuminating wave and a signal wave. So this is the type of situation that we're imagining. We've got a volume phase hologram, and we've got a red reference wave coming in, a plane wave, that's then interacting with the grating and producing a signal wave. And the principal result of coupled wave theory is it allows us to understand the diffraction efficiency of the grating and also to understand how that, i.e. the brightness of the grating or the hologram, varies as a function of wavelength and angle. Kujelnik's theory is analytic, but it's also approximate. Maharman Gaylord solved the wave equation exactly on a computer, and they showed that Kujelnik's analytic theory did provide a very good description of the unslanted reflection grating, but at higher index modulations, rather higher than we're used to in holography anyway, it overestimates the diffraction efficiency of the slanted grating. And differences in the transmission grating occur at a rather lower index modulation, producing different diffractive orders, for example, but again, quite high compared to the kind of indices that we're used to in display holography. So Kujelnik's theory is analytic. It also provides us with useful answers concerning the diffractive response of most gratings. But for me, Kujelnik's coupled wave theory is not incredibly transparent. And in particular, conventional coupled wave theory has to make various mathematical assumptions, and some of the assumptions, to me at least, aren't that clear or weren't. So this state of affairs led me to think of perhaps thinking of another more simple explanation or a simple model. And then this led to a semi-rigorous, that is rigorous in certain cases, namely the unslanted reflection case, led to another analytical model of diffraction, and this was based on Fresnel reflection. And the idea is that you have infinitely many mirrors. Of course, various authors have thought of this idea of a volume phase hologram being composed of many mirrors. And it's also the basis of what's called the chain matrix method for calculating the diffraction from thin films. And these ideas date back to Rouard in the 1930s and to Abelis in the 1950s. And in fact, even in holography, a lot of people have thought of these ideas. Maharam and Gaylord, for example, have used the chain matrix method to examine the unslanted reflection hologram and compared that with rigorous coupled wave theory. And various other people, Ludman most notably, Solomer and Cook, Nin, Diehl and George, have also used these ideas in the context of holograms. But what's different in the present work is that we consider an infinite number of parallel stacked mirrors, and that this leads to a rigorous differential formalism which then results in an intuitive theory, or I hope it results in an intuitive theory, which is analytic. And mathematically, this is actually an alternative, or you can think of this as an alternative coupled wave formalism. So, starting simply, Fresnel in the early 19th century introduced simple mathematical formulae for how plane waves react when they encounter a discontinuity in the index between two materials. So here we have two different refractive indices, and we have a plane wave going between or hitting this discontinuity and producing a reflected wave and a transmitted wave. And the simplest situation is to think of normal incidence. And then we have a reflective wave, and everyone probably knows here that the reflective wave is then of an amplitude which is just proportional to the difference in the index between layer one and layer two. So using these Fresnel formulae, you can start to think of a volume phase grating. So let's think of a volume phase grating as being composed by a finite stack of layers. We envisage a wave, the red plane wave coming in, and we then, that passes through various steps in the index between layer of index N1 and layer index N2, N3, et cetera, et cetera. And then at each index step, via Fresnel's laws, these will produce a back reaction, if you like, or a reflection, a transmission, and we will get a signal wave generated. So mathematically, we can look at this by formulating it in terms of a recursion relation. So we can say, for example, that let's take any one of these layers, the interface, let's take a general interface, and we'll say that the amplitude of the wave there, it's got a component from the downstream amplitude of the wave times a transmission constant, but it's also got a component from the oppositely traveling signal wave, which reflects back again. And mathematically, you can write that as this recursion relation. I won't dwell on this because I said I wouldn't make this a mathematical paper, but basically that formula just says the amplitude of the reference wave at a certain point is equal to its value at a point downstream times the transmission constant plus a reflected signal wave coming the opposite direction from upstream. Now this is the chain matrix formalism of the thin film model, so it's known. But what's interesting to do is take the limit of infinitely many mirrors. So let's squash that distance between the index layers, and let's keep the gradient of the index with the distance into the grating finite. Then we get a differential formalism. So the equations at the bottom are an exact analog to the equations at the top. And it's interesting because these equations at the bottom are in fact exact solutions of the wave equation. You add and subtract them and you'll get energy conservation and you'll get the wave equation. Now if you think of monochromatic illumination and you think of the reference wave just being a single frequency and you think that its path through the volume phase hologram is such that it doesn't change too quickly, i.e. it hasn't got a periodic structure which is of a similar wavelength to its wavelength, then this solution, this equation has analytic solutions. And the analytic solutions of those equations, which you can get in about two lines of mathematics, will give you these equations here, which are, I'm sure you'll recognize, or a number of people recognize, as Kojelnik's equations. So you can get Kojelnik's equations exactly from Fresnel reflection. Just the only difference is that you have slightly different coefficients. I've listed the coefficients here on the right. The Kojelnik's equations have certain coefficients. Alpha here is the ratio of the recording wavelength to the replay wavelength. Theta is his dephasing parameter. It shows how far away from Bragg resonance you are. And so at Bragg resonance, you get the same coefficients. Away from Bragg resonance, the results are a little bit different. So these differential equations have the same analytic solution because they're the same equations between PSM, this theory I'm talking about, and Kajelnik's. And the analytical solution can be written in terms of diffractive index, eta, and we can, for instance, plot this. So this is a case for a grating, a monochromatic grating, recorded on a material like silver halide, because we've got an index modulation N1 of about 0.045, 7-micron thick emulsion, and we're plotting a graph here of wavelength versus diffraction efficiency. The Helmholtz computation is an exact solution of the wave equation, so that's exact. And the red line is Kajelnik's theory, and the blue line is the PSM analytical model. And you can see that generally in the center, everything's the same, and in the wings, Kajelnik model is slightly dephased from the numerical solution. But the Fresnel model gets the right solution, or it gets a closer solution anyway. Now, that was really the simplest case. You can rigorously extend this to an angled case for the unslanted reflection grating, and you can do it for different polarizations, S and P. For Kajelnik's theory, it's again more complicated to do it for different polarizations, but it's really just the same for the PSM theory. So here's another example. This is a 12-micron thick unslanted reflection grating. Replay wavelength 550, recording wavelength is 532, and we're plotting diffraction efficiency of the pi polarization versus angle, so changing the reconstruction angle. It was recorded at 30 degrees. And there you can see, again, same situation. Kajelnik misses a little bit the wings, but otherwise the solutions are very similar. PSM, however, can model polychromatic gratings in almost exactly the same way as it models monochromatic gratings. The original differential equations that I showed you are correct for polychromatic gratings, and they're correct for any index profile, in fact. And you can get analytic expressions under the assumption that if you record a grating with 2, 3, 4, 5 wavelengths, they're not too close together. And here are some results, again, for typical holographic grating, 7 microns thick. Again, an exact solution of the wave equation. And then comparing PSM, well, you can't do it with Kajelnik now because it's polychromatic, but you can compare with an exact solution of the wave equation. And you get very close results. You'll get a slightly closer result, as you can see from the tops of these curves, if you use a numerical estimation or numerical solution of those differential equations. But the analytic forms like this are very, very close and are very useful. So this leads me on to a slightly different sort of discussion of just using this and how do we use this to give us some intuition of what happens in color gratings and color holograms. Hans was always discussing with me, you know, the diffraction efficiency of color holograms, and if we have 2, 3, 4 colors, can we expect to get unit diffraction efficiency? And I think this model shows very clearly that you can. And don't forget that I'm modeling a lossless hologram here. We can extend it to the lossy case later. But for a lossless hologram, if you increase the depth of the hologram, here it's plotted in microns, then for a two-color hologram, as we see here, the diffractive efficiency approaches 1 as you get very thick. Of course, if I was to plot the corresponding case for a hologram recorded with 1 wavelength, I get a higher diffractive response here. So I'd get a curve on the top of here. So having 2 or 3 wavelengths certainly depresses the diffractive efficiency, but nevertheless, increase the thickness and you'll get unit diffractive response sooner or later. Another interesting thing that we can model with PSM becomes obvious is that when you record a two-color grating, suppose we record it with 532 nanometers and 532 nanometers, well, that's a one-color grating, we get a certain diffractive efficiency, the 0.9, let's say, here on this diagram. If we move that second color, then the diffraction that you get from the grating depends in this fashion upon what that second wavelength is. And here it depends quite radically. Obviously, the gratings beat together, and so if they're quite close together, you get a radical departure. As they become separate and distinctly separate, then you get less of an effect. The red curve is the PSM theory, and the black is the Helmholtz exact solution. So this is the three-color case. I plotted some graphs for two-color before, and it's an exact analog, so I won't dwell on it too much, but this shows three-color hologram, and the red, green, and blue replays and their diffractive efficiencies. As the grating thickness goes to infinity, so the diffractive efficiency at red, green, and blue goes to one. So I've discussed slanted gratings, I've discussed unslanted gratings. How can we make this work for slanted gratings? Was a simple mathematical technique. You take the differential equations that I showed you earlier, and you just rotate them into a frame where it's slanted, and then you can solve those differential equations analytically for the boundary condition of your slanted holograms. And I see my light's gone orange, so I'll speed up perhaps. But this is a 12 micron grating recorded at 532, so we come back to the monochromatic case. But it's showing now the replay wavelength, a minus slant of the grating for, I think it's 40 degrees or 30 degrees, no, 40 degrees slant, and comparing Kolchinik and the PSM theories. And you see you can get a very, very close match. So what else can PSM do? This alternative coupled wave theory of parallel stacked mirrors. Well, PSM can give analytical expressions for the general polychromatic slanted grating, slanted reflection grating. It can also give analytic expressions for three-dimensional tilts. So you can think of gratings not just one dimension, but in two dimensions. And you can get simple analytic expressions for the diffractive efficiency here. PSM can also describe transmission gratings. And for the monochromatic case, you get exactly the same result analytically as Kolchinik's at Bragg resonance. Away from Bragg resonance, some small differences. PSM can also treat mixed phase amplitude gratings very, very easily. Just let the refractive index be complex. Also, you can extend it to N-coupled wave theory, and you can do this polychromatically as well. So just very quickly, one does this mathematically by just thinking of the volume reflection grating as a series of parallel stacked mirrors, but at different angles. And so Kolchinik's theories or the PSM one-wave theory maps over to these equations, where you just get a sum over the waves instead of, you can see the similarities. And maybe there will be some of you who recognize these equations, because these equations are none other than the equations derived by Solimar in the 80s for N-coupled wave theory of the traditional type. So my conclusions are that volume gratings and holograms, and in particular reflection gratings and reflection holograms, can be understood very conveniently and intuitively by a proper consideration of Fresnel reflection from an infinite series of discontinuities in the permittivity profile. And this means, from a practical sense, a volume reflection grating really just is a set of many parallel stacked mirrors formed by the continuous index distribution. So you can think of a reflection hologram as mirrors, and that's relatively rigorous, at least in the unslanted case. This consideration gives rise to an alternative coupled wave theory, and the mathematical formalism of PSM constitutes a differential representation of the well-known chain matrix model of thin films. And for the monochromatic case, PSM performs very well compared to Kolchinik's theory, and in some cases it produces better accuracy than Kolchinik's theory. In other more extreme cases, you can find cases where Kolchinik's theory produces slightly better results than this. So it's complementary. And for the polychromatic case, if recording wavelengths are relatively separated, then PSM provides analytical expressions which agree very well with the numerical solution of the wave equation. And if the recording wavelengths are closer together, then PSM provides a simple numerical a procedure for calculating the diffraction efficiency. And again, this numerical procedure agrees very well with the wave equation exact computations. And above all, PSM is an easy, intuitive theory which allows a simple yet powerful description of polychromatic gratings and holograms. Thank you very much.
Yes, I have two questions. One question is, when you say an infinite stack of discontinuous, I assume what you're doing is you're bringing the distance between each stack to the limit so that they go to zero, essentially. But you still model a sinusoidal profile throughout the stack. Is that correct?
That's correct, but actually the profile can be anything you like.
Okay.
It's the original differential equations I put up were general for any type of index distribution. And they're exact solutions of Maxwell's equations.
Right. But you still assume that there is a boundary, that there is a, you know, a thickness to it, obviously, right?
Yes, absolutely. You assume an outside region and an inside region.
Very good. I forgot my second question, but I'll ask you afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you.